2 diabetes with GLP-1 receptor agonist. Yes.
Thank you so much, Chairperson, and thank you to DiaCareCon for inviting me for this topic that is very near and dear to my heart. So we will start with our obesity symposium. We're talking about not simply weight, but why does it matter? And what is this holy trinity or the unholy trinity of weight, glucose, and cardiovascular risk in type 2 diabetes? And how can we impact all three with a simple molecule? So let's move on. For the purpose of this talk, I am contacted by Novo Nordisk. These are my financial disclosures. So this is the agenda of my talk. We will first talk about what is glucose, what is weight, and the CV risk. Move on to benefits of weight control, and then see why it is imperative that when we treat diabetes, we must treat weight first. This was the statement at the ADA held in the US this year in June 2024, that we must not simply think of treating glucose, but we must have an extra glycemic approach, think about inflammation, think about other things simply beyond glucose control. Can I have some more light in the room, please? It's too dark in the room, I can't see the audience. RX events, please. So what is this uncontrolled HbA1c and excess weight? Did you know that more than 88% of people with type 2 diabetes are overweight or obese at the time of diagnosis? Only less than a third of patients with type 2 diabetes across India have an HbA1c which is under control. So that means most of our patients are uncontrolled. So we are neither treating the obesity, we are neither treating the diabetes, and hence we need to work on both. Now, what is the way we can approach all of this in a very effective manner? As you know, type 2 diabetes, the main driver is obesity, genetics, a sedentary lifestyle, history of gestational diabetes, and PCOS in women, and our race and ethnicity. So being South Asian Indian, we are the thin fat Indians, and by definition, we are at high risk for type 2 diabetes. Now, if you couple this with a family history of diabetes as we age, for example, women at menopause will become diabetic, they will also have high cholesterol, heart disease risk, everything happening at that time. With the current stress, you just heard our chairperson speak this morning that how stress is an important role player for causing type 2 diabetes. And obesity by itself is the number one cause for causing type 2 diabetes. So we need to keep all of this in mind and simply not treat the blood sugar of our patient, but think of this as a patient as a whole and work on all of these factors. Now, this is a very busy slide, but I'm going to make it very easy for you. Number one, I'm going to tell you, forget everything you learned about diabetes. We only heard about diabetes. What is the thing that comes to mind? Insulin, insulin resistance, pancreatic problem, liver glucose production. I present to you diabetes as a new inflammatory pathway. And this is what you need to keep in mind, that there are the fat cell in the body. I'm an endocrinologist. It is the largest producer of hormones in our body. It is not the pituitary gland that we used to think of, but it is truly the adipocyte, the fat cell, and this is causing so much local as well as systemic inflammation at the level of the pancreas, at the level of the beta cell, in your visceral circulation, and at the level of the liver. This offsets a chain of cascade of the inflammatory markers such as interleukin 6, 8, 17, TNF-alpha, interferon gamma. All of this in turn leads to inflammation at the level of the pancreas and the liver, causing increased hepatic glucose production, dyslipidemia, lipotoxicity. You know, the classic diabetic dyslipidemia that we say is a high free fatty acid, high triglyceride, and a low HDL cholesterol. Now, what this leads to is a new molecule which is in the pipeline known as an endotrophin excess production from the liver. And truly, endotrophin will be the next generation marker. We shall soon forget, hopefully, about just treating HbA1c and focus on treating our patient as a whole. This offsets an endothelial and platelet dysfunction and what we call as oxidative stress, plaque development, plaque rupture, and eventually a myocardial attack. So this is what we need to keep in mind, that type 2 diabetes, obesity, CVD are all tied by the common pathway of inflammation. So let's learn how we can better reduce this inflammation and not simply treat diabetes. If you work on the anti-inflammatory pathways, you will be targeting obesity, diabetes, CVD, MAF-filled and future risk of progression of many diseases. And therefore, I now will move into the pathway as to how do we go about working on this. As I just showed you already, more than 88% of people with diabetes are overweight or obese. Remember, we are the thin fat Indians. And now here are some other data. 80% of people who have coronary artery disease are also overweight or obese. More than 2/3 of deaths related to a high BMI. What do we die from? From a CV cause. So with this background in mind, now let's see how does this also impact a country like India. We are a developing country, and being overweight or obese can cause an increase not just in indirect costs, but also in total direct costs to the healthcare system. And therefore, if you invest in your wellness today, we will be able to prevent investing in sickness in the future. So what are these benefits of weight control? So how much weight? You cannot tell all your patients who walk into clinic, and we have started getting these patients with 100 kilogram plus weight nowadays. You can't ask them to lose 30 kilograms, right? That's unreasonable. So I'm just going to ask the audience. So if say you get a patient who comes in, 42-year-old gentleman, he's overweight, obese, has pre-diabetes, family history of diabetes and heart disease. In the first 3 to 6 months, I don't know, anyone can answer, how much weight do you ask him to lose? Yes, sir. Okay. So his answer is 1 kg per month and 6 kgs in 6 months, and that is a reasonable amount. It's not scary. Now, what are you trying to change in him? That is my question. Just the weight scale? Like I said, don't treat HbA1c. I'm also saying don't treat weight as a number. What are you chasing? Why do you want to lose weight? Pehle to bolte the na, achha weight hai, khate peete ghar ke log hai hum. So why are you trying to lose weight? What do you want to reverse? Tanvi? Insulin resistance, good answer. Give me some answers. Do you want to save him from dying? Death is a good reason. So let's say reduce mortality. Obesity leads to increased mortality. What do you want to prevent? Somebody, come on, one more thing. He said he's scared of diabetes. Always listen to the patient. He's scared of getting diabetes and heart disease because that runs in his family. So we always target our goal setting for what the patient wants. What is the number or the percentage weight loss you need to prevent diabetes? 10 to 15% to reverse diabetes. To prevent diabetes, simply 5%. What is 5% of 100? Who's a good mathematician? 5 kgs, very easy. So 5 kgs, but how fast? In 3 months. So sir, you were right on the track that we don't need to do a lot, but probably maybe instead of 1 kg, if we can push them to lose those 2 or 3 kilograms per month, because the first 3 to 4 months matter the most. Therefore, I urge you all to learn how to do goal setting with targets in mind. If we can get our patients to lose about 5 to 8%, we are the thin fat Indians, so don't follow weight as a number, following body composition works. We now have molecules that can help us to do, if the patient is affordable, if they are unable to do diet, if there are other risk factors. I'm not saying we need to start expensive molecules or really dramatic treatments right away. If they start on a diet program, all studies have shown the highest weight loss will happen in the first 3 to 4 months. Therefore, keep them engaged, keep them coming back to you. Do not give them a diet plan or something, metformin, I don't know, whatever you use, and have them come back after 3 months, because then they will lose only 2 or 3 kilograms in 3 months. Let's set a target. Tell him this data. If you lose 5%, you will reverse your chance of what you are scared of. And you will have an engaged client, a client who's willing to work with you. As you can see, I've spent so much time on this point because that is the crux of the matter. Now what I show you will hit home. You will remember it. You will walk away from this room knowing how to do goal setting for your clients and how to approach this. So targeting weight early, this is what I'm trying to tell you. This would be what a good doctor does. Writing medications after they have diabetes and heart attack, everybody does that. Let's do the upstream approach, that is focus on weight as the primary approach to treating type 2 diabetes. Not only does this promote glucose control, it impacts your cardiometabolic risk factors by working on the inflammatory pathway. You're reducing the inflammatory fat cells to convert them from inflammatory to non-inflammatory. 3 to 4 months also is your golden time period, and you will in the long term prevent disease as well as complications such as the micro and the macrovascular complications. So weight reduction, as we all know, greater weight loss, greater reduction in HbA1c and fasting blood glucose. Somebody said 10 to 15% from the direct trial. We know that a 15 kilogram weight loss reversed diabetes in 97% of the patients. We also know as a follow-up to the direct trial that if you sustained the weight loss, the diabetes stayed reversed and in a reversed condition. Now, weight reduction leads to diabetes remission. You can see over here, more than 15 kilograms, almost 86% of these patients were able to reverse their diabetes. So moving right along, the oldest study and my favorite study, I never get bored of quoting this, is the Look Ahead trial, which was done. It was not as intensive as a direct trial. They were trying to see if you could affect cardiovascular mortality. And what did they find? More than a 10% weight loss in type 2 diabetes and obesity reduced this risk by 21% at the end of 1 year. And what was the primary composite outcome? Cardiovascular death, non-fatal MI, stroke, or angina. So this is very important to keep in mind. I'm sorry. Oh, my slide is not changing, guys. The slides are not changing. Thank you for pointing out. Yeah, it's stuck over there. Sorry for the delay over here. Technology is great when it works. Therefore, I'm still keeping paper backup in my office also. यहाँ पे हो रहा है लास्ट स्लाइड आ गया लेट्स डू कंट्रोल एस्केप कर लें ले दो एफ एन एफ एट में नहीं हो रहा है या श्योर Bear with us. I have 7.5 minutes. I'll wrap it up in 5 so I can take questions. So don't worry about it. You already know the most important part of the topic is? Oh my God, you don't. What is the most important part of the conversation with your patient? What are you going to set with them? Which weight reduction goals and targets based on what you hear from the patient? Because sometimes a patient will come and tell you they want to lose weight for getting pregnant. So then that's a different kind of weight loss. Someone wants to lose weight because they want to look good, right? Then you have to target. So we get people who want to build muscle, lose fat. Since we are in a diabetes symposium, for the purpose of that, we'll stick with the diabetes reversal, composite outcomes, cardiovascular mortality, those type of things. So I think I'm going to try to just talk about an oral molecule known as semaglutide because I only have now 6 minutes and apologies for the slides not being shown. This is better, old school. If you give me a chalkboard, I can just draw actually, right? We've seen too many slides. Whole day you're going to see slides, so just focus on me for now. So what is semaglutide? An oral GLP-1 molecule, the only oral GLP-1 molecule we have in the market. So let's learn a little physiology today since there's no slides. I'm not forced to show data, which I know most of you don't enjoy anyways. So what is an oral GLP-1? GLP-1 is a hormone which is not insulin. Of course, it doesn't join ever last very long. All right, so we'll move right along. So I spoke to you about targeting the Trinity, the direct trial, as I was telling you already, the Look Ahead trial, wherein about a 10% weight loss only led to a 20% reduction even in cardiovascular outcomes. And therefore, we have a lot of data from this beautiful study that reduced blood pressure, reduced triglycerides, improved HDL and LDL. But just improving parameters is not the thing. It also improved endpoints. So that is why it's important to keep in mind how weight loss benefits not just disease progression, but also macrovascular events. And see this, just a loss of 5% in body weight. Okay, 5%. I have selected all slides to make you understand target setting. When you walk out of this room, you please say you learned goal setting with your patients today. I don't need you to memorize trials, but I need you to understand when to use this data, how to approach your patients, right? That doing this, I can reduce by 48 to 50%, the chance of having a cardiovascular event in my patient. So that's a golden number to keep in mind. Okay, so greater the weight loss, greater is the improvement. This slide, all of you have seen, if somebody already has cardiovascular mortality or HFpEF, you need to lose even more weight, 15%. Of course, it becomes more challenging. Last but not the least, we will talk about oral semaglutide. As I said, this was revolutionary. So far, we did not have peptide hormones that we could give by the oral route. And patients in India, a needle is a needle. They prefer oral tablets to needles. So what is GLP-1? Remember, in response to an oral glucose load. So when you eat, you start releasing this hormone known as GLP-1 as well as GIP. In the next room, there is going to be a GIP talk later on. So GLP-1 is the molecule that is released from the L cells of the intestine, and it works on improving insulin secretion, maybe making more insulin cells. It also works at the level of the satiety center to improve satiety, reduce appetite. Thereby, the weight loss effects and the glucose control effects are very different. We take advantage of these effects because now GLP-1 receptors have been found at the level of the heart, at the level of the brain, and may have, what I spoke to you earlier, multiple extraglycemic benefits. How did the company do this is that they used something known as a snack molecule. And this was co-formulated, the native GLP-1, which protects the semaglutide breakdown by the gastric enzyme. It's very important how you take it. First thing in the morning, empty stomach with just a sip of water. For 30 minutes, you cannot take any water, any medications, nothing after this molecule is to be consumed. So that's important to instruct your patients. And it gets absorbed from the gastric epithelium. Now, this is, as I mentioned to you, the world's first and only GLP-1 receptor agonist, and it is co-formulated with 300 milligrams of snack. So very often the patients want to break the tablet, take two tablets if they have 7 milligrams left over. Cannot do this, okay? We know from several of the pioneer studies that it works as monotherapy, it works as dual therapy. Here's what we are going to focus on is the CV safety. So you can see in Pioneer 6, oral semaglutide versus placebo in high-risk patients with existing CV disease or CV risk, it worked very well. And what I'm going to show you is that there was a significant, robust HbA1c reduction up to 1.5%, almost up to 3%, depending on the starting HbA1c. We also know that weight reduction up to almost 5 kilograms with oral semaglutide. And coupled with a good diet, we can also enhance this up to 10 to 15 kilograms. So therefore, this molecule works not simply on glucose, but also helps in weight reduction. We also know from late, you'll be hearing from my other colleagues today about other effects on the heart and inflammation. Real world data. So you can do this easily in your clinic. You can see that we have data also from India over here. Again, HbA1c reduction up to 2%. Weight reduction up to 5 kilograms in the Indian subset. Now, of course, another important thing that I really like about this molecule that we do not see severe hypoglycemia with this molecule. It has an established safety profile because that's something we worry about in all our patients. Last but not the least, it also can be used in renal disimpairment, liver disimpairment. Of course, bear in mind if they already have pre-existing nausea, you need to work with these things in the clients. Now, the CV safety, as I was mentioning to you, from the Pioneer 6, you can see which was a CVOT outcome for oral semaglutide, 21% MACE reduction, 50% reduction in CV death, and a 50% reduction in all-cause death. So I would say that after SGLT2 inhibitors, this is the molecule that made our jaw drop. We need to understand when we can use it and use it efficiently and effectively early in the upstream approach of diabetes. So beyond glycemic control and goal setting for your clients, that was the crux of my talk today. As you can see, we need to address weight early, by which we can not simply work on diabetes, we can reduce CRP, which is the only marker we can currently test clinically in our clinic practice, reduce blood pressure, improve all parameters of metabolic syndrome, nephropathy, as well as we can use it even in patients who have had an ASCVD event. Therefore, I urge you to think of these molecules early and have an upstream approach in your patients with type 2 diabetes. targeting not simply diabetes but cardiometabolic risk as one of the major approaches in your patients with type 2 diabetes. Thank you very much for your attention. I've stayed right on time.